So when I think of like good data scientists versus great data scientists, like a good data scientist indexes to value, understands what the business is actually trying to do, and can deliver outcomes. Like a great data scientist.
Hey, I'm Molly from Springboard, and I'm here with Ian Blumenfeld, a chief data scientist at Clover Health. Hi, Ian. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Hi, thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
Let's start out. On your LinkedIn profile, you say that you do data science with a product bent. What does that mean to you?
That means that I tend to focus more on the use cases and the applications versus the methods and the methodologies. It basically means if I'm going to do something, I will start with, like, why might this be valuable? Why might this be useful? Versus, is this possible and how would I do it?
You've been doing data science for 10 years now. How has that role changed over the years?
The biggest difference has really been that you need to be able to, if not write production code, at least interact with production software systems now. 10 years ago, if you could write SQL reports and then send them off to someone to make a decision, like, that was good enough. Now, it's kind of hard to make a high-level impact if you can't write code that like, you know, 10,000 or more people are going to like interact with through some kind of software product.
Let's talk a little bit about your own startup. Mm-hmm. Do you want to give us a little bit of a background on that?
Coming out of my first job, I just sort of had an itch of like, I want to do something for myself. It was a healthcare data machine learning based startup. It was a complete and total failure.
What were some of your biggest learnings?
I mean, the big meta learning is essentially like the market has to want something for you to do it. Like, just because you think you're a smart person does not mean that you're going to build something that anybody wants. Having that experience of like launching a failed product helped me get a lot more critical about my own work and also the decisions that I was making going forward in terms of like what I should be working on and who I should be working with. And so I ended up developing through that an owner slash investor mindset. So when I went to look for a job after that, part of what I was assessing was essentially like, all right, if I go work for this company, like I'm basically making a large investment in them, right? Even though like other people are putting up the capital, like I'm putting up my time. And so is this a thing that I have reason to believe could be successful? Is it well set up? Is the environment ready for it? I look at my current job and say like, all right, like what should I be spending my time on? Like it's through that same lens.
So now, present day, you are a chief data scientist at Clover. What are you doing there, and what problems are you currently solving?
Clover's still a startup. We're on the larger side of startup at this point. I do a lot of work on our machine learning platform, kind of looking at what kind of models we can produce to do a good job of really identifying health risks so that our clinical teams know where they should be focusing their resources. And I also spend a fair amount of my time kind of thinking through how we can address the problem of like, what next? Anyone who works for a commercial operation basically knows at this point that the machine learning and the predictive modeling part is a relatively small slice of the problem. And once you get models that start to perform, the next question that you're going to get is, okay, now what do I do? So I'm essentially starting to spend more and more of my time like working through that part of the problem, which is half like understanding, well, what do these models actually do? And then half kind of like understanding from our operations perspective, like what are their capabilities and how do we figure out how to match those things together?
How has your role progressed through your data science career?
When I first started, I was I was writing a lot more code than I do now. Part of that is tools. Like the tools have gotten way better over the last 10 years, which means I have to write less code to solve the same kinds of problems. But part of it is there are more people that sit around me that can help. And so that means that like I have to spend some amount of time figuring out like, all right, who should be doing what, and like how do I lop off parts of these problems that are really appropriate for people at different stages in their career development. I do a lot more mentoring than I did, and I spend a lot more of my time thinking through like what problems should we be solving versus like how do we actually solve them. This is where the breadth becomes useful because then you can say something like, okay, we need to solve this problem. Like, here's kind of the classes of types of methods that might be appropriate. Here's a few papers and blog posts that go into them, and then I can kind of send someone on their way. I used to do all that stuff myself. I don't do all of it anymore.
A lot more delegation now.
I think of it as like less delegation and more like giving other people opportunity to like step up, because you know if I keep all of the interesting parts of a problem to myself, like hey, great for me, but like someone else is sort of losing the chance to like try to do something interesting and valuable and useful.
You spoke to how your role is currently a little bit more about mentoring. What does mentorship mean to you?
It's really about helping folks build a framework within their own careers for how they should be making decisions, so that they can own what their career path and their career progression is. I think there's a tendency, especially in large companies, for people to come in and say, okay, the rubric looks like this. I am a level 4 and I would like to be a level 5, but you as an individual like also need to have a view of where you would like to go. And there's places where that's going to align to the rubric and places where it's going to diverge. And where it diverges is kind of like your opportunity to take risk and to like try to do something. But if you don't have a good framework for sort of understanding, well, how do I make those kinds of decisions? It can become very hard and you end up just playing the video game of like, oh, now I'm a level 5, now I'm a level 6, and then you look back after 10 years and say like, is this the career I actually wanted? You're lucky if the answer is yes.
Outside of foresight and a bit of risk-taking, what do you think it takes to be a good mentee?
Curiosity, humility. There's just lots of stuff you don't know. And a willingness to try things. The people that I've mentored that I think have gotten the most value out of it are the ones who basically said, okay, I want this mentorship is because I think I should be doing something different than I am doing, and are then like willing to actually go out and do that different thing. If you're not willing to do something different than you are currently doing, it's very hard to get anything out of mentorship from anyone, no matter how good that mentor actually is.
What are two things that you feel sets apart a great data scientist from just a good data scientist?
So when I think of like good data scientists versus great data scientists, like a good data scientist indexes to value, understands what the business is actually trying to do, and can deliver outcomes. Like a great data scientist, like has, you know, creativity and judgment like wrapped up in that package. So that means that number one, like not only do they understand what the business is trying to do, they also can map that on to the relative priority of like, well, what should they be working on? And so they're able to identify like, all right, like out of these 10 possibilities, like these two problems are by far the most important ones, and that's where they're going to spend their time. And, you know, and the other 8, don't even think about it again. And then they can also like look at a set of methods or a set of prescribed solutions to those kinds of problems and basically know, okay, like this is solved and I'm going to copy here or listen to the experts here, but like this area, like this doesn't look right to me. And so, you know, then they can dig down and reason from first principles and figure out like, where do I need to be contrarian versus like just do the thing that all of the papers say that I should do. Like great data scientists exit the rubric.
All right, now it's the time we've all been waiting for. We're going to have some lightning talk questions. So first, where's a good place to go to find a clean data set online?
For me, I don't believe in clean data. Yeah. So like you want to do a project, go get the dirtiest data you can find and like go use that.
Perfect. Dirty data.
Yeah.
Okay. SQL, Python, or R? You can only have one.
Python.
If you were not a data scientist, what would you be, Ian?
I would be a policy economist.
So if you could go back in time and tell your young data science self something, what would you go back in time and say?
Don't worry about your job title. Worry about the company that you work for.
Yeah, I would love to open it up if you have anything to plug.
For the past 6 months or so, I've been doing a data science adjacent podcast that kind of goes through softer side of data science. So like beyond the technical skills, like how do you solve problems? How do you reason through problems? All those sorts of things. It's called Small Differences. You can find us on Spotify and on iTunes and on Twitter at Of Differences.
Well, Ian, thanks so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.